I want to give you just a little virtual tour of some of West Virginia wetland complexes, and I'm hoping this may be helpful as you're reviewing wetlands in West Virginia. If you're in or near one of these big complexes, you'll know you're kind of in a special area. So throughout the whole state, there are alluvial wetlands along our streams, and there are vernal pools. But we do have parts of the state where we have some particularly nice wetland complexes. And so if you have a project in those areas, it's just nice to be aware that they're out there. You'll be able to see that when you look at the GIS viewer at all the scores, because you'll see there are parts of the state where it's all kind of blue and purple, they're really high scoring, and parts of the state where it's just normal colors. But the Ohio River wetlands, the High Allegheny wetlands, the Meadow River wetlands, the Marl Marshes, and the Summit sinkholes are the five special areas that we have. And so I'm just going to show you a few of these. So the alluvial wetlands that we have statewide, things like water willow meadows, this is along the Greenbrier River, very important for protecting the riverbanks. This would be one of those vegetation fringing open water wetlands. Buttonbush swamp is a common type encountered throughout the lower elevations of the state. It's not in the highest elevations, but also very high value for habitat and a pretty common alluvial type, often associated with streams and rivers, oxbows. Vernal pools are throughout the forested areas of the state. They're important for amphibian breeding habitat primarily. The site we're at today had those two big vernal pools that are now dried up because it's no longer spring, but very important for breeding habitat for amphibians. Along the Ohio River, the natural vegetation there is largely silver maple swamp with a little bit of pin oak swamp. And there are a few of these still left along the Ohio River, although most have been destroyed. There, they also tend to have little oxbows and open water areas mixed in with them along the old channel of the Ohio River. The eastern spadefoot toad is one of the creatures that uses these. This type of habitat is really important for them. In the Meadow River, we have a big headwater area, which is largely full of pin oak and black ash swamp. The black ash is dying now, and as is the green ash and the white ash and the blue ash, all the ash. But the pin oak still is with us. So these are very beautiful, full of rare species. If you're in the Meadow River, it's almost impossible not to hit a rare species, either a plant or an animal. Things like the cattail sedge or the fringeless purple orchid. And we have Diana fritillary butterflies that breed in here. The marsh blue violets are their larval host. So a lot of rare species associated with those really large pin oak swamps around the Meadow River. Over on Short Mountain Wildlife Management Area in Hardy County, there's some really interesting rare swamp types. We hope there will never be projects in Short Mountain. It's one of those exemplary wetlands. But this pitch pine cinnamon fern swamp is one of them, where you have carnivorous sundew and Canada burnet. And it's a globally critically imperiled community. There's only, I think, 6 occurrences in the world, 5 of which are on Short Mountain. So it's extremely rare. Also extremely rare are the Summit sinkhole wetlands. They're in Hardy and Berkeley County in the Ridge and Valley. And these are sandstone collapse features over karst. So you get a big limestone cave underground and the sandstone collapses into it. So they're acidic. This is the only home in West Virginia of the northeastern bulrush, which was just delisted. It was a federally endangered species, covered under the Endangered Species Act, until about a year and a half ago when they delisted it. It's still not very common, but there's enough of it in Pennsylvania where there's also a lot of pressure to delist things, so it got axed. Our marl fens over in Jefferson County, they are really extraordinary ecosystems. These are ancient fens. Marl was formed during Pleistocene times in shallow ponds by chara algae precipitating down limestone and just calcium and magnesium that formed eventually marl from the limestone and dolomite substrates. So they're almost always spring-fed from limestone and dolomite springs. And full of rare species, again, very special habitats, very heavily encroached on by agriculture and development because the Eastern Panhandle is so crowded. And the story I love to tell about the marl fens is that of the Carichium snail. So when you are doing surveys in marl fens, you always come across these little Carichium snails. They're just one of the dominant invertebrates of the marl fen. And we brought back peat samples to our snail biologists at the DNR. The peat there is 10,000 years old underneath these marl fens. And it looks like Rocky Road ice cream. It's full of shells all the way down. And we said, can you identify these, you know, ancient shells? And so our snail biologist said, looks like Carichium. And we said, all the way down? He said, all the way down. It's Carichium from top to bottom. 10,000 years of little Carichium snails living in this very stable habitat that now is almost gone. There's just postage stamps left of it. They're still there. And so it's sort of like, yes, this is a place we really don't want to impact. They've kept going through all through the hypsothermal, through all kinds of changes. Let's not be the death of them. And in West Virginia, kind of the jewel in the crown is our high elevation frost pocket wetlands. I'm sure you've all hiked in Dolly Sods and Canaan Valley and Otter Creek Wilderness and Cranberry Glades. These are frost pocket wetlands where water and cold air pool in these high basins and create conditions that are very similar to northern Canada or Alaska. And we have a ton of species that are rare because they're disjunct. They occur in northern Canada, Alaska. They jump down the Appalachians to our frost pocket wetlands, and they don't occur at all, say, in Pennsylvania. And so these are very special places. There are also some really large wetlands full of wonderful species, generally dominated by red spruce as the dominant tree there, but rare species like the saw-whet owl or Bartram serviceberry or long-stalked holly. These are all globally rare species, that at least the plant species are. The balsam fir swamps in Canaan Valley. Maybe some of you have heard of Canaan fir or bought a Canaan fir, the seeds used for the Christmas tree industry. They're wonderful balsam firs. And this is a great place to see a fisher or a blue crayfish, a Monongahela blue crayfish, or you know, beautiful showy lady slipper orchids. These are some of the most diverse habitats, perhaps the most diverse habitat in West Virginia. I think when we do 20 by 20 meter plots and look at all of the species from the mosses and grasses and forbs right up to the trees, plant life, and we were getting over 100 species per 20 by 20 meter plot, which is I think the highest diversity of any vegetation type in West Virginia. So again, a place we really don't want to impact. Up along the Allegheny front are these pitch pine heath peatlands. You can see them on the Northland Loop Trail if you go up to Dolly Sods. Beautiful pitch pines. Pitch pines are a bimodal species that grows where there's no competition. It's just a terrible competitor, but it's really good at surviving extreme environments. So you find it in nutrient poor, acidic wetlands where nothing else can live, and you find it on acidic dry cliffs where nothing else can live. And so these pitch pine heath peatlands, again, home to all kinds of rare species, running along the Allegheny front, only a few square kilometers of this vegetation type anywhere in the world. It's all in West Virginia. No one else actually has this type of wetland. And it's where you find the moose dung moss, which is one of my favorite mosses. it grows on deer dung as well as moose dung. So, but yes. Then up in Cranesville Swamp, up in Preston County, We have our cranberry beakrush fens, and also up there, American larch swamps. It's the southernmost extent of American larch in the United States that comes into Cranesville in that frost pocket. So these, again, are ancient deep peatlands, very special, very beautiful. And we already saw the Otter Creek Wilderness, this beautiful up at the top of Salt Lick Run. It's just an incredibly gorgeous wetland up there. No trail to it, surrounded by a quarter mile thick rhododendron thickets. So people just don't get in there. You have to be really determined to see this wetland. And as a result, it's in pretty much pristine condition. It's fabulous condition with the rare orchids, gentians, and carnivorous plants.